So Carl, you've been at Google for a while now, and it sounds like, wow, 6 years, and it sounds like prototyping has changed over that time. Can you just sort of talk a little bit about how that's happened?
Yeah, you know, prototyping has evolved quite a bit in my tenure at Google. When I first came to search, for instance, almost 3 years ago, we were focused heavily on creating web products, specifically for their desktop users. Mm-hmm. Google's shift has grown significantly over the last few years, and we've gone mobile first. And so as a result, I've had to evolve with the times and have also shifted my development practices towards doing full-time Android development.
Mm-hmm. So you now sort of lead a team of Android developers.
That's right. So I lead a team of four people specifically looking at search, map, and identity products across Google.
Awesome. And I know you've worked on some things in their earlier stages. You know, that's one of the joys of prototyping, is you get to see these things before they happen, and some of them never do happen. But can you tell me a little bit about working on material design?
Sure. Material design was a fantastic project to work on. We spent about a year ramping up on that before we ever released anything to the public. Mm-hmm. I think in its infancy, we were thinking about it. We called it quantum paper. And we were really thinking about this idea that it was digital paper. Mm-hmm. And so we were thinking about how does digital paper do things like respond to touch? How do we show layers, for instance, inside of that digital paper landscape? We made a number of prototypes across the early stages of that project. We even did some really ugly ones with like some really bad electronic mesh-like touch responsiveness stuff. Mm-hmm. That ultimately, we did away with a lot of that stuff in favor of a really simple UI, and so that's where we ended up going with the touch ripples, right, for instance, in Android. I think a much better experience for our users. It's a little simpler, a little bit cleaner, and I think as a result, a bit more delightful than some of the early mesh Tron-like stuff we were doing.
Right, that makes sense. And so some of these decisions you made to sort of scrap this version of a product and come out with this simpler one, was that made based on user feedback? Was that made based on some other kind of feedback? Was that made sort of out of the blue?
Not really out of the blue. We got tons and tons of feedback. So we as a group of designers and developers were sequestered for a couple of months working on the project. We got lots and lots of feedback from not only the executive sponsors of the project, but then a number of design stakeholders, as well as a lot of users that we did tests with. Mm-hmm. We did some guerrilla, like cafe-style testing across the Google campus. Mm-hmm. We even brought in outside trusted testers to give us their feedback on the experience.
So you mentioned that native prototyping has sort of come to the forefront at Google.
That's right.
Can you talk a little bit about why that is and sort of what you get out of that you wouldn't be able to get out of just a web prototype that you've put on a phone?
Sure. One of the areas that I think we have focused a great deal of energy is actually in prototyping voice experiences. Mm-hmm. This is an area that we can't do a whole lot as far as the web side of things. For instance, we're limited by some platform vendors in the access that we have to their APIs. Mm-hmm. So going with a fully native experience means that we get a much wider set of tools that we can work with. Mm-hmm. So for instance, in the Android SDK, we get much tighter integration with voice components.
Right.
We can do a really beautiful voice experience, lots of delightful animation around that experience as we bring that prototype or that application to life.
Perfect. Thank you.